This online training has been organized as a part of the government initiative to Rajendra University of Sciences to reach out to as many doctors as possible. We had a online meeting on last week actually. We have recorded the proceedings and have been shared on the YouTube and other social media. We expected all the doctors to go through the YouTube, and if they have any further queries, we have a panel of doctors here, panel of experts who are ready to take the questions and then clear your doubts. That is the only way we can reach out to a large number of doctors. So I hope all of you have gone through the YouTube, and then you can start shooting up your questions right now. We have a panel of doctors. They will introduce us, they start taking the questions and answer your queries. I hope whatever doubts you have, you can ask directly or through chat box, and each of the questions will be answered to your satisfaction. I think we shall begin. You can shoot your questions right now, right away. Arun Kumar, Dr. Ravikiran, Sachin, Dr. Martesh,
being chatted.
Vijay Das, Dr. Manjula, Dr. Ramesh. There are quite a few of you. If you have any doubts, please raise the issues here.
Before asking, please introduce yourself, your name and which place.
Sir, I am Arun Kumar speaking.
Yeah.
I am a student professor, Department of Physiology. I have a basic doubt regarding the number of patients with respect to coronavirus. Have you reached the peak or yet to reach the peak, sir?
We are now expecting this week a more number of cases, and by the end of this week, we will know whether we are flattening or we are still moving up. So till this weekend, we have to wait. That is primarily to look into whether a definite community transmission is in place.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sachin, next question.
Yeah, there was one question which was.
Antibody
screening. So, as you know, the ICMR has just approved the antibody. I'm Dr. Sunil Karant. I head the intensive care unit. So, as you know, the antibody screening has just been released, has been approved, I think, Thursday or Friday, for clinical use. But right now, the guideline is to restrict it largely to what we call as cluster areas or hot zones. Because the idea of that would be to pick up patients who may be negative, but might have been exposed to infection. So the pathway is that if it turns out to be positive, you treat them as an infection based on clinical examination, based on maybe a repeat nasal swab RT-PCR. And if it is positive, if it is negative, of course, you have to definitely do an RT-PCR and make sure it's negative. And if it is negative with a negative antibody test and a negative RT-PCR, then you'd assume that influenza-like illness. So that's the general guideline for now. So I think largely it will be employed for around the cluster or around a primary contact to see if there's been any secondary contacts from people who have been in contact with the person having the infection.
Sachin, are you hearing? You're hearing properly now?
Are you able to hear us?
Sachin?
Hello. Hello.
Are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Did you get the answer from Dr.
Yes, yes sir. The in such a manner that could we depict it as a graph over a period of time? How do we actually see the transition over a period of time? Because when people in the community as well as we just wanted to have an absolute idea about how it would progress through a graphical representation.
I think as I told you previously, let us wait for the data to come. In addition to some data that has come following that daily episode, which has driven the numbers up, we'll wait this week, and by the end of this week, we'll come to know in what direction the graph is going. That is one aspect. Now, second aspect is ICMR, is regarding this antibody testing. Okay, there is a, please visit the ICMR website for visitors, it is good. And they have given a flow chart explaining how to go about this antibody testing. And once this kit, they are expected to take up this kit again. And one, I think it is expected to start in the contact screening and then maybe fewer clinics and then it will be operationalized. But anything we do it in a very proper, systematic way. There is nothing to rush. We are doing good in the given circumstances and other relative state. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. I also had a small query regarding testing of the number of individuals, more number of individuals. So, once the kit is ready, could we be testing?
Yeah. Say, once this antibody kit become available, we'll definitely be testing more people. And they are asymptomatic, they are not, we'll be testing them. Yes.
The idea of population screening is very difficult to test a person, suppose if they are in the high risk area or some other places where large number of people would be present. So we would the role of antibody testing in population screening is to take, so these are like a rapid test kits where we can take the test kits to the population and test the result. I mean test the test the COVID virus. And suppose if they turn out to be positive, then we again confirm with RT-PCR in the specific laboratory. The idea is to screen this mass population or to reach population. Recently, as the panelists were suggesting, there has been a discussion and ICMR has been so whenever, but only thing is there will be very sensitive and specific related to antibody testing. And another thing is like probably need to wait a few more days because again the quality of test result depends on the development of antibody in the person. Probably it takes some time to develop antibodies. So whenever there is this kind of testing is happening, there are certain steps, but I think this is a very good strategy to see if it at the community. And the only thing is that should be confirmed with respect to this. So I just given an example in the other public health program where it has been very successful. For HIV positive people, particularly to high risk person, if you want to do initially there was a protocol, these people can be tested like EGDAS and other communities and all. Testing would have been conducted. If they come out to be positive, they would be part of the ICT. And again, test should be confirmed with the regular test and it would be declared that positive based on the treatment. So that is the idea of doing antibody test and in the population.
And in India, in the Indian context, one of the observations made was the testing is very low. So with this antibody titer testing, we are definitely going beyond the symptomatics and in the community settings, and number of testing also will be more, and the outcome will change, will decide our strategy. Thank you. Thank you.
One more question. How would be the transition be in the coming days? Epidemiologist transition of COVID-19.
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir.
Online.
Sir?
Yes, please.
Hello, sir. I'm Dr. Vijay Das. Associate Professor from the Department of Physiology, Medical College.
Please. Go on.
I have put my question in chat box also. My question is, there may be many asymptomatic carriers all over. So how to identify them and how to manage these cases? Until unless we know how many of them are carrying asymptomatically, it's difficult to control them. How to manage them, sir?
See. From a general epidemiological scenario, it has come from other countries. This has come later to India. Okay, after China and other countries, infection is important, and we are some breach behind other countries. Okay. So the information which has come from the earlier countries is small percentage are asymptomatic carrier. Okay. Now, with the introduction of this antibody
vectors, the right hand is an phone.
Come to know what is the prevalence of infection? Symptomatic, asymptomatic. Now, your question is, this is among ourselves as a group of professionals. Even if asymptomatic carriers have infected people, they will develop disease. Fever cannot be suppressed by paracetamol. Cough cannot be suppressed by cough syrup. They will appear to the medical system. They get detected. Okay. So even from US and all, you will be getting many queries how India is able to manage as compared to many of the developed countries and including China and all. Our approach is good. Though it appears conservative as compared to other countries, we are progressing. If you don't have confidence in the number of figures, at least look into the number of deaths. Number of deaths. Deaths cannot be hidden. Okay? So, look in the all India scenario as an epidemiologist. Draw your own conclusions. Have confidence. We'll move forward this way. We'll navigate this way.
Thank you, sir. There is a question regarding introduction of online theory classes. Normally, if I understood correctly, it should be medical college students. I share my experiences. We started online theory classes in Akashic Medical Science. Basically, you need to have a dedicated IT team for it, or if not, a person who understands IT system very well. And there are various apps for this. One would be Zoom. Zoom could be the most ideal and user friendly. That's what we are using in our medical college right now. And there could be other apps like GrabX and various things. There was also Skype, but again, the clarity was kind of. It's an issue. Whenever we are conducting online hearing classes, some of them are free, some of them are subscribed. So you can take a subscription from the respective number of individuals. Like we have taken a subscription for 500 courses in our college. Basically, according to me, it was 4,000 students. Totally around 4,500, we have taken a subscription for 500. Accordingly, we have prepared a timetable and we have estimated this. Classes with their respective timings and all. The four different groups we require. Suppose if you take four classes, we require four different groups. I just example. And all those things can be conducted. For that, we need to conduct the training for our respective staffs. completely my experience, it was not easy, but it's not very difficult also. I mean, now since university suggested, probably everybody can be done there. So till we start, it will be a little bit cumbersome, but once we start, it becomes very easy. Only thing is, wherever we create this kind of online platform to the students, there is a meeting again which needs to be created and which needs to be designated to students. Just like whatever we need to do today to conduct this session in the Webex, you need to do similar to the student group and students should log in. I mean, they can log in using the laptop systems or even in the mobile phones. Accordingly, the specific hours, the staff will come and conduct the teaching classes. And there is some issue with the taking attendance. Probably we can always, if another staff assists, we can always take attendance whenever students like the number and all. So, and in the online teaching classes, it is like a very simple process. There is a PPT which needs to be inserted and like a teaching. Only thing is, you won't be roaming around. You need to sit in a chair and you need to take a class for a moment. End of the session, students, just like Facebook Live, students will have all the queries on the chat box. So then you, if you want, you can answer all those things.
What we are doing is
Same thing, sir. This is very suggesting. Whatever we are doing, same thing can be applicable to production of these classes.
Just to give you information for you, online learning platform has been already started by all other faculty members except British colleges. Some medical colleges have been very slammed in there. Online teaching is going on very well in nursing, pharmacy, homeopathy, even in Ayurveda it has started going on very well. I think when medical college also started, it needs a lot of planning. Once the panel is good, it will be done. Shortly we will start in the medical college and that's the problem.
What
do
we
have done?
Medical college we have started. Different guidelines, describe different PPE, working.
Hello sir, can you hear me? Dr. Ranjit, sir.
So I think the question is about what are the different guidelines describe different PPEs for personal PPEs, what should we wear? I would advise you to write a book by the ICMR guideline, which has given clearly, even the government of Karnataka. So, at the moment, I think the recommendation is to use the N95 mask even in the fever clinic because you don't know who is in contact, who is a patient who may or may not be having COVID. There are only certain places where 3-ply mask is indicated when they are out of the patient care areas. That's something where you can think about the 3-ply mask. Otherwise, I think right now N95 is the one preferred even in the flu clinics, especially if you are coming within a weaker contact.
Dr. Satyanarayana Mysore. Ivermectin is something that has come out as an anecdotal evidence from Australia. But even that has come out in the last 3 days, if I'm not wrong. And there are a number of abstracts that are coming up. There are also a number of communications coming up. Ivermectin, we have done in the first session is to go based on evidence-based. On the ICMR and our university state guidelines. On the basis of that, there is no role for ivermectin at this point of time. If by chance, if you want to administer, you need to get a special consent form for that or administer as a trial once it is okayed by competent authorities. Otherwise, we would not be recommending ivermectin.
Anybody ask some question? Chal Kumar.
Hello, sir.
Carry on.
Sir, Dr. Ravi Kiran, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, carry on.
Sir. Sir, this is regarding the theory classes online, sir. Sir, especially in a government college, what happens, including the pre-para faculties they are utilizing for to start up the hospital, and there's over two hospitals we are running, sir. One is a COVID hospital, another is a regular hospital also, sir. So because of this, including a pre-para, most of the faculties are involved in the hospital work, sir. So is it possible to do at least one person for the institution, they can do the theory classes and it can be disseminated to the, all the students?
Currently, as Vishy sir was pointing out to your question, like online theory classes have been started in nursing, Ayurveda, pharmacy, and other systems. Medical college, some of the medical colleges started them, students, some of the other institutions. Like I completely understand, research will be very busy. Pre-para can take the thing. Currently, we are seeking our online theory classes. It is only for the theory purpose, we are not doing anything else. Like with regard to case discussion or something like that. I mean, our college experiences tell that, like, today many people have, even though they are clinicians, they are busy, dedicated person has, will be assigned and he will come and take the theory class. It does not take much time, you know, it is like a regular class where you can run the PPT for 1 hour. But I think, I know it is not easy, but it's not very difficult. We probably need to do a lot of advocacy at the hospital level and everything, and this can be definitely. And again, a lot of, I mean, if not all the theory classes, at least we can start some theory classes for some of the batches. Like, we are not running from morning to evening, we are taking class, for one batch, like 3 to 4 subjects, it would be from morning 9 to 1, something like that. We are taking and we are finishing off. I mean, but again, you can definitely try and do this because you never know like how long this is going to continue. And that's a matter of interest now to conduct online theory classes so that students are also benefited from this. Probably, I mean, this will be like a big learning experience. And whenever there is such issue, hope man, it will not have that kind of situation. Probably in next year when I have similar situation, probably we need to carry on. So begin now, so the better late than ever.
Okay, sir. Oh, this is my small suggestion, sir. Because what happens, the resources can be optimally used. Because one faculty, if they take in a physiology, means they can take the physiology of the student. It's, is it possible, sir?
Like yeah. Again, it's totally understanding that's what we have a team. Suppose somebody is totally involved in the clinical care, that's what would be there in the class. And we are involved in everybody, clinical, clinical, clinical. So, and suppose somebody is totally involved in the clinical work, that's what are not in clinical work, they have to take the class.
If you have some questions on COVID-19, please. Yes, please. Just as a professional request.
Sir, I'm Dr. Arun Kumar again. Hello.
Yes, please, sir. Can we avoid
that? Sir, what are the research forum that is available for people to do research on COVID-19 related aspects, sir?
One is, want to do any academic clinical trial, as per new drugs and clinical trial rules, it says any currently available drug, if it is to be used for a new condition, in a new dose, in a new route, or in a different formulation, you need the approval of the ethics committee. From the head of the institution. You can obtain these in writing, inform the DCGI under the current circumstances you are doing an academic. The number will be single digit number. Ethics committee approval means there will be a signed witness, inform, consent. Need for an audio visual recording is something to be EC chairman has to decide. And once the EC approval is obtained, and then site inform consent is taken, you as a research team, with consent, you can do it.
Sir, so what about
how you can do it? Collecting social level related information and all that is the routine thing. That is a separate issue. But any clinical intervention, academic clinical trial is an option which is to be explored. I have a clinical research background. I am with NABH. I am familiar with this. I have already given some approval for COVID-19 in relation to some other context in a private hospital, of which I am the ethics committee chairman. So please explore this EC approval for an academic clinical trial.
Sir, is the same rules applicable for biomedical instrumentation projects also? Related to COVID, biomedical instruments related project to COVID, like safety devices, wireless devices.
See, from 1st April 2020, that is just 2 days back, now these medical devices also are under the Drugs and Cosmetics Act. Okay, so that is a different ballgame. I am not familiar. I am only aware that there is a list of medical devices which have come under the Drugs and Cosmetics Act from 1st of April. So, let other questions be taken. And if you want, you can take from the list of those equipment. I think the ventilator is talking that.
To answer your question in that absolutely slate. It's a G9-1, and so far around 27,300 students have logged in. So that's a G9-1. You can go ahead and enter your name.
One more question.
So can you add it to some people are
saying that? In audio, they have to select the device, speaker. Can only.
Can you
hello? Everybody able to hear? Hello?
Hello?
Are you able to hear?
Yes sir.
Yaar
general.
Okay. Some have a problem in hearing that. Can I know who?
Hello.
Yeah, go on.
Sir, may I speak? This is Dr. Jayashree from BGS Global Institute of Medical Sciences, sir. Sir, I had a concern. This is with regard to swabbing and testing of patients, sir. I also had a request in the task force group with regard to having a mobile swabbing team, which will probably save a lot on our PPEs and all. Because we've been asked to swab patients and send them for testing, and logistically it was becoming very difficult for us because we probably have one or two cases which would need swabbing, and it would be a lot of taxing on PPEs and other aspects. So we wanted to, I had asked in the state group with regard to providing mobile swabbing facility, sir. Is that possible? Can that initiative be taken up by the university or something like that, sir?
You are recommending a South Korean approach, if I am understanding your question correctly. currently we are following Government of India guidelines and ICMR guidelines and also government. We are taking the samples, throat swab and nasopharyngeal or RT-PCR from a definite group of suspects, and we cannot find, there are also certain preconditions where to take the swab, who will take the swab, what is the PPE requirement for that, then collection, transportation also. So under these circumstances, if the Government of India permits, we will not be able to do such authoritarian activities in India. That is point number one. The process we have come now, a little deviation, but reinforcement is the antibody type kits. So we have come from the swabs to serological testing. So this is all that I can give at this moment. And I will tell you, thank you, Doctor. I will answer this new drugs and clinical trial rules and the list of equipments which have come under the Drugs Act from 1st April 2020. One is all implantable medical devices, CT scan equipment, MRI equipment, defibrillators, dialysis machine, PET PET equipment, X-ray machine, and bone marrow cell separator. So here you need about ventilator, it is not specified here, and it is not an implantable medical device. So as of now, yes, it is not in the act, but you will have to approach your ethics committee on any interventional ventures in your institution.
Thank you, sir.
You need to learn to achieve a loss of 4 years.
One more question of state.
Yeah.
RGT is putting here, uploaded a Google form.
No, that
is the answer. Yes, yes.
Do you have any questions on NCQS, any queries? There are intensivists and pulmonologists. You can ask them, or if you are very clear, I request our panelists to speak on NCQS, which is one of the hot topics, or it is becoming cold. Yeah, please, over to our panelists.
So, chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine. On to this COVID pandemic, and there are physiological reasons why this came into. One other thing, if you look at any edition of Harrison, you will find that chloroquine has been discussed or described as an immunomodulatory drug, and specifically it has been described in a short paragraph saying that it is a weak base salt, and that will change the ionic polarity of the lysosomal membranes. Therefore, the egress of the virus into the cell membrane is going to be difficult or not possible if the drug really works. However, the French investigator who came up first time with the chloroquine did the trial on 22 patients. If we look at the declaration of Helsinki for clinical trial methodology, this trial does not fit. There is no control arm. It is not a randomized control trial. It is more of an observed trial. During this observation also, there were pitfalls. The reasons for why patients dropped off from this trial was not very clearly documented. So out of 22 patients, one died, one went into ICU. 3 to 4 patients, one did not tolerate hydroxychloroquine. And there was no reason specified as to why, what was the intolerance issue. About roughly about 15 patients had mild symptomatology and they did well on chloroquine and azithromycin. So the question is, a scientific rational question that comes to mind is, would they have even done that without chloroquine? So there is no evidence to the contra. Secondly, there is concern of chloroquine itself is known to prolong the QT interval. In conjunction with azithromycin, it is almost that we have to take every step to make sure the patient doesn't have a QT prolongation, which will lead to TASAR. Therefore, there is a bigger question of arrhythmias. And the second and third trial led by Gao and In from Chinese, they did a slightly bigger number, but they actually concluded their trial saying chloroquine did not have any benefit. So now the American Surgeon General or Medical Advisor Dr. Anthony Fauci, who is a don of infectious diseases, very respected seasoned person, he opined that chloroquine he would not jump and give it to each and everyone. But the American administration and the political forces, given the desperate times, there is always a cry for desperate remedy, and they have taken up chloroquine in a big way. So our ICMR guidelines, with a view to protect its healthcare workers, gave measures about prophylactic use of chloroquine in healthcare workers, point number one. Point number two, contacts of proven COVID patients. So these are the only two groups that ICMR has recommended the chloroquine prophylaxis. The treatment itself, yes, they have suggested the chloroquine. However, it is upon individual institutions to ensure that a special consent is taken. If we look at the good clinical practice guidelines, GCP, chloroquine, what are the most ideal things to do before you start chloroquine? One is to get the aphthal referral. Where possible, make sure there is no pre-existing maculopathy. Chloroquine is known to give rise to melanin retinopathy, pigment retinopathy. But the argument that is coming from everyone is, I have used chloroquine as a rheumatologist for many years and on many patients. I have not seen a single side effect. Now we are in 21st century medicine, evidence-based medicine. Pandemic will create a situation where we would like to try anything and everything for the welfare of patient. Having said that, even there are issues like QT prolongation, pigment retinopathy, and other gastric side effects, it would be better to kind of look wherever possible, get a ECG, look at the QT interval and compare it with the preceding RR interval if possible, and then consider chloroquine. Now, when you are combining with azithromycin, you need to be very careful. Please don't get swayed away by the media reports. There is a couple of American family physicians who have published news reports. They have used zinc salts and they talk only about oxidative injury, and that all their patients were quite mild in nature. There are some caveats. I think Dr. Guru Prasad Bhatt, a pulmonologist, if you have a perspective to share.
Because in there will be within his patients, those contacts of
hemoprophylaxis.
And other than that, the other drugs. For example, even when they are using the excipients on the other side.
And a subset of patients with COVID-19, area-wise, region-wise, country-wise, there was different pathologies. If you look at the Chinese patient cohort, more of pulmonary pathology. If you look at Italy, it is more of cardiomyopathy and cardiac arrhythmias that were seen. Therefore, and the French replicated some portion of what the Italian patients had. Therefore, the dictum we all know, do no harm should be our first motto. Consider, profile your patient, calculate the risk and then decide.
Is there anything you want to add on?
The other issue that I thought we will highlight during this question is there are number of incidents happening, you know, violence and communication issues, most of them. Therefore, in this age of social media, every common man has an algorithm. Every common man has dosage of the drugs. While it is very, very important to treat patients, it is probably equally important to actually keep the stakeholders engaged. Because you treat them with chloroquine, they will come and tomorrow say, I say, for guideline, why are you not giving lopinavir and ritonavir? So, or they may come and say, why don't you look at API106, which is a new experimental drug, which is looking at blocking the ACE2 receptors. So there are going to be number of things. It is just that when we look back 30 years ago, we practiced medicine differently. Today, I think we'll have to practice little differently. And any questions on?
I have one query. Many of my friends who are in private practice, they are after concern that they need to take, as they could be exposed to the patients in the practice.
Having a proper informed consent about what is happening. Yeah. On their individual choice, they can. There is definitely no hard data to say that there is some harm, especially when somebody is on hydroxychloroquine, presents with some sort of anaphylaxis. We end up giving them either a lipoprostate say or important that a person who takes it is aware of the pros and cons. It may be beneficial. In fact, if you look at the guideline within a matter of 2 weeks, the ICMR guideline itself has changed That itself is an indication that you still don't know much or enough about what is happening. Number two, I think WHO is about to embark on a trial, 4-hour trial. Maybe by then the pandemic will be over, but this is something we will have to do. In fact, if you look at our previous experience from oseltamivir also, today we know that it doesn't actually cure the infection. It only reduces the severity when taken within the first 72 hours. So, if you look at the two experiences, we are talking about the viral infection, we are talking about something. Probably wait for the results of this new trial.
Regarding this personal prophylaxis, and personal protection, against it would be wiser.
Hello.
Just
But today, HCQS prophylaxis is reserved for a certain group who are directly dealing with COVID patients. So not for medical fraternity who are likely to see all common ailments. So that is one thing. Now we will go to another topic. This is a group of clinicians. We request you to take their wisdom of clinical practice. What about convalescent serum? There is one person who has come, who has waived his privacy, confidentiality. He is appearing in media and he is cured from COVID-19. Hypothetically, he will give his serum also, a plasma. So there is another thing which is in the news. So what is your take on that?
Yeah, no. It is very humbling experience.
Yeah.
We are going back to the
Edward
Jenner era.
So please,
and convalescent Zira preformed antibodies are known to provide protection. And especially, but very important that we need to consider which patients will be tried.
So it is also there. Clinically ill.
Yes.
So before he was under the ventilator or whatever it is, if you ask this gentleman, you know, who has gone in the mass media, he may give his
it raises a very important question.
Yeah.
So
well, you will get ethical committee
informed
consent also.
I think all of our doctors need to follow this algorithm.
Yeah.
Somebody comes and claims, I have had COVID-19. First, do a serology.
Yeah.
If the IgG is positive, then do not take the plasma. Do a swab. So the current guideline that is already shaped is that if you have preformed antibodies, antibody positive, and your swab is negative, and this is in a healthcare worker, fine, welcome, you can go back to your work. Antibodies are positive and swab is positive, that means you still require quarantine or healthcare service and your plasma cannot be taken because you have still not cleared the virus. Then the third category is antibody is negative. Antibody is negative does not mean he can jump back to work or anything. It only says susceptible, status unknown.
So
that was the answer. We have answered quite elaborate. Yeah, nice. So always go by the, I think the ICMR has released the algorithm. Very, very simple algorithm. So do not go by, if I come and claim that I've had COVID-19 one month ago, take my serum. Don't go for it. Check, follow a particular algorithm before you take.
So many other, there is a question.
Yeah.
Prophylaxis for all.
Hello.
ICMR guideline says all healthcare workers. Now, the way we interpret that,
this is actually, it is not possible.
Quarantine.
Quarantine.
What is gross coloring COVID?
One egg.
No, there is
COVID has positive patients and other care
if they are if they, patients are not in quarantine, better not to start your
quarantine. Who are quarantined? They are apparently healthy persons, contacts. Who are apparently healthy persons, no symptoms, who have shared some commonality with the cases of suspects. So that's why they are kept for 14 days of the incubation period. Another 14 days of reporting period. Then they are released from this captivity. Okay, for 28 days they are kept under observation. So they are apparently healthy persons. They don't develop any symptoms. If there is no problem, they run to any other healthy persons thing except for this physical restrictions and other prerequisites. And otherwise they are fine. Otherwise they are fine. Today we have persons in quarantine in an institution, in a hotel, and at homes also. The three places they are in quarantine today.
Yeah.
International passengers in physical survey, and then international passengers of a younger group, they have moved to their homes for home quarantine, and the primary contacts of the cases have been now quarantined in Bangalore in a hotel.
I have one query.
Yeah, you can ask me.
Yeah, because, see, their question was framed in back. Currently, they are all suspect. But what if they are two wrongs? So we do the testing at the end. Probably some of them may develop symptoms, if not in the first week, second
week. The healthcare worker,
yeah,
who is attending to quarantine patients,
yeah,
if it is in a healthcare facility,
yeah,
could actually be on chloroquine prophylaxis. Then there is no doubt.
Okay.
ICMR guideline says,
yeah,
all healthcare personnel involved in care of COVID-19 patients.
But these are all like not patients, these are all suspects.
Later
they may travel.
It's only a matter of 2 days.
Yeah.
2 days later, if he comes positive,
yeah, that's what my question
is. Therefore, you are a doctor, you better be on prophylaxis, because we have seen so many standalone clinics getting patients and then they come to designated hospital and turn to be positive.
Let us move on to the next topic. And regarding ICMR, please advise everybody to follow only ICMR guidelines and not with the WhatsApp University guidelines. Please, because most of the people are going with the WhatsApp messages, and especially the unemployed people, they are starting the ICMR on their own. They don't understand it. They are adding more masala to make it worse. Please advise them. If they have got real doubts, they can meet any professionals.
Let us see the compliance and tolerance of Indians. As for the ICMR guideline, see, SCPS is not a easy to tolerate drug. Am I correct?
Exactly. Very much.
So, I have some active information to this. Some other bad experience. It's not a easily tolerable drug. And next, about BCG.
Next question is about from consent. I think we touched upon it briefly.
Yeah, yeah.
So the question is, should treating doctor obtain informed consent for treating these regimens prescribed by ICMR? I think it is good to get consent from the patient, just because this is tested waters. Just a formal thing that you discuss with the patient that this is a drug which is we don't know much about, but if there is some data, there is some risks in involving this or in treating this patient with this particular regimen. If you are okay with that, we go ahead.
And you can say this is approved by ICMR. But I would still like to discuss with you, and at
least it varies by institution to institution. In our institution, we definitely we have prepared a special consent form for all of the drugs. Because this is a disease that there is no, but no one is a guru. No one has all the answers. And the main thing is watch this space. The evidence will unfold.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, 1 minute, yeah?
Yes, please ask.
Hello.
Yes.
Start the question.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Ramesh Masti from KIMS, Bangalore. Yeah, I just wanted to ask the clinicians in the panel out there. The 4,000 odd patients who have been diagnosed in India, I mean, do we have early data on them? What is their clinical presentation? And who are the people who are surviving? What time, what stage are they? If they are intervened, they are able to pull through. And the people who are dying, what is the, what exactly is the reason why they're dying? And then the last one is, what are the different regimens that are there? There are different cocktails.
Aware of any such information being available in
the age
group. Somewhere in the WhatsApp, I have seen the age distribution of the thing that people. If we report, I think we will look into that. I am not aware.
Yeah. Only the gender and age, they are given. I think that. Information that we have is that about 60% come in that age group of between 20 to 60. So only 17% are above 60. That is something which we need to be maybe worried about, because it looks like majority of the patient in our age group in our country seem to be the most productive age group. But yeah, it's still very, very early data. I don't think we have anything much more than that at this point.
What about the treatment regimens that are being followed?
Again, not much data, what has already been used, what we only know is the guideline which has been put out.
Very few patients have been treated actually with hydroxychloroquine. Most patients have received antibiotic within 1 hour of admission.
Okay.
Other than that, mainly supportive treatment.
And what about the role of the... the lamivudine, I mean the ritonavir and other, is there any evidence of those being used in India?
No, only patients were from the Jaipur. Jaipur patients were given after ICMR clearance was obtained, but that is all in the news.
Okay, okay.
So they did develop a serum sickness like reaction following treatment with lopinavir and ritonavir. And other than that, we have no live data, and I don't think it has been used extensively.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. See, there is one question which says general coping contains insecure smiling and respiration and exhausted thoughts in the country. Was that a wrong decision to put that information completely? See, this social media is a double-edged weapon. It cuts both ways. Has helped in a large extent to put the people in their homes. And really, two things, one is the social media, another is the police on the roads. They have really ensured discipline in ourselves and compliance to lockdown norms. But the CQS in social media and in the mass media, can work both ways. So people are aware, they have gone and over the bridge, and over the company. But still, in our country, you know how drugs are procured. They have paid the money and they have taken the drug from the pharmacy. That's all. So there is nothing which can undo this now. We'll have to live with that.
So there is a question on tracking of hospitalized patients with SARI, pneumonia, who are tested for COVID-19 criteria, who core of testing strategy. Practically many are missed, especially pediatric. So I think number one point is every stakeholder in this pandemic, whether it is state governments, whether it is universities which are roped in, or corporation health authorities, national government, everyone needs a round of applause. And the reason is this: I think for all these years, TB contact tracing and other things have given a cutting edge to our ASHA workers, healthcare workers, and others. So the contact tracing or case tracing has been exemplary, is the uniform consensus. I do not think patients have been missed, or at least if it is, it would be in smaller decimals. Pediatric, unfortunately, I have no idea about. Very hard to miss kids. And kids remember that they neither have a well-developed ACE2 receptor or a well-developed type 2 pneumocyte. And very mild symptoms are seen in the kids for this particular reason, presumably. So now the government is thinking about designating a private hospital for kids alone.
Just to add to sir, whatever is telling, contact tracing is exemplary in Karnataka, thanks to Sudarshan sir and all the other
government
of Karnataka. So the thing is like, based on my experiences, actually, same cannot be said about other states in India. Probably go to UP, Rajasthan or Bihar, probably we can't expect the same level of contact tracing what we do in Karnataka. Whatever we are talking, Karnataka definitely has some really based on our experience. That's why we are seeing a very, very less number of infections in our state compared to others.
Any comment on BCG vaccination? Let us answer all those. Because
many years ago, there was a theory of hygiene hypothesis. Hygiene hypothesis, best example is Bangladesh in India. At the highest percentage of groundwork and hookworm infestation. And the incidence of ulcerative colitis was lowest in this population. If you compare with the Western population, where worm infestation is probably non-existent, the peak of weak incidence of ulcerative colitis vis-a-vis Crohn's was very high. The basis of putting forth this hygiene hypothesis. Now, in the 90s era, as and when newer frontiers in immunology was being described, people decided to say there is TH1 and TH2. Then came the IL-10 and TH1. So, three different arms of immunity were described. So, TH1 and 2 is very simple to imagine. It is like a balance. If TH1 is quite active, the kid or child has been exposed to a lot of infections, TH1 will be predominant and TH2 relatively suppressed. So, that is the population that will be able to fight infections very well. The opposite is true. In a country where living standards are very high, there is every possibility that the immune system to fight the intracellular or parasites or bacteria, viruses, whatever, to be a little blunted. Their propensity for autoimmune diseases may be higher. Statistically speaking, this seems to be favored. recently hygiene hypothesis was kind of proven to not to be so true, or lack of evidence for hygiene hypothesis. Now, what does BCG do? BCG 101% is not going to kill the SARS-CoV-2. It's not going to touch corona. It's not going to do anything to the bacteria or to the virus. It only may have a role in enhancing cell-mediated and humoral immunity of the individual. Therefore, the natural killer cells may be more primed to tackle the virus. So that is all about BCG. Now, there are a lot of observations being done. Pandemic is always a master, and we are all the students in a pandemic. Nobody has complete total authority on a pandemic. Now, if you look, people are looking at Western world where BCG was considered to be of not of a great efficacy. Indian studies have put the efficacy of BCG to about 66%. However, the opposite is being replicated in the study. This was
Liverpool. 2%.
Therefore, the Western world dispensed with BCG. Now, all the eyes were on our country. They said the poor sanitation, low socioeconomic strata, healthcare structure is not good, and that COVID would wipe out and cause a devastating scene in our country. But if we compare head to head, day 1 to day 23 with the Western world, our data looks better. Our data looks very clean. We seem to be in control. We have not even yet gone into stage 3. That is when people started feeling what could be the reason for this. And one of the reason they thought is, okay, Indians are getting BCG, we are not getting BCG. So that is an observation. And coming time, and even if you rapidly start immunizing the Western world with BCG, it's not going to pay any dividend. It will take years before you develop cell-mediated and humoral immunity to some extent, mainly cell-mediated. Very interestingly, people are pointing out to the fact that the milkmaids who used to come and serve the supply milk could not develop in the good old days because they were exposed to bovine milk, whereas other people were exposed to. So that is the journey. 1949, if I am not wrong, BCG vaccination was started in 1949. And we have included in the universal immunization, continues to be there. The role of this needs to be, looked up later on. Data needs to be cleanly looked without any bias and say, did it have an impact or not?
So the take-home message is, currently there is no scope and no role for BCG vaccination in COVID-19 pandemic. That's all. Simple. Now, the next thing is, for those who are in private hospitals and are managing COVID-19 patients, from my NABH clinical research approach, expertise, my recommendation is, please formulate an institutional policy as a practice to manage COVID-19 patients in your hospital. Get it approved by the institutional ethics committee and head of the institution approval, and then take the informed consent as per the guidance of the ethics committee, and then confine to it very scrupulously to avoid any litigation later.
Everything else. Yeah. Any other questions in the matrix?
Any question?
Thank you for participating in this panel. Especially, I'm sure most of our panelists have indicates of their experience that have clarified all your doubts. And as far as possible, please, whenever you come in contact with any of this general public, tell them to follow the ICMR and government accredited Karnataka guidelines and not the WhatsApp University guidelines. I'm sure, as Professor Sudarshan said, it's helpless. But the same way, it has really causing a lot of confusion, especially in the threats and in several issues. Henceforth, regarding the transition of any drugs and patient questions, because even ICMR is updating every day. So we have to secure it. Thanks, everyone.
One question.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any method to improve its coming? 23.
Yeah, this one. Anybody wants this?
Yeah, shall I?
Yeah, we will.